If you want to learn more about this NIS2 Technical Implementation Guidance that was published by ENISA, then this video is for you. So I'll explain the basics of this guidance, but also how it is structured. So I'll show you all the sections in this document, and I'll also show you how to create your own policies and procedures based on this guidance. So after you watch this video, you'll have a clear idea on how to use this guidance in practice. Okay, so let's start with the basics. So this guidance was published by ENISA back in July 2025, and ENISA is a European cybersecurity agency, so basically a government body that let's say supports cybersecurity in the European Union. Now, the purpose of this guidance is not directly to support the NIS2, but actually this Commission Implementing Regulation, or CIR 2024-2690, and this CIR focuses on describing the cybersecurity measures for two sectors, for digital infrastructure companies and also for digital providers. So out of these 18 sectors that are specified in NIS2, this CIR focuses only on these digital critical infrastructure companies, and this CIR provides very detailed requirements on what these digital companies must implement. Now, since these requirements are quite complex, this is why ENISA has published this guidance that provides, guidance for implementing all of these requirements. Now, you can take a look at my other video, which explains CIR in more detail, and there is also another video which speaks about who needs to comply with NIS2, and these 18 sectors are listed there, as well as these two sectors that are part of these 18. Now, there is one important thing that you have to know about this guidance, and that is it's not mandatory. So all of these things that are mentioned in this guidance are only recommendations, so there is no real requirement for companies to implement those. However, I find this guidance very, very useful, so it's in any case recommended that you study it thoroughly and see if you can find anything useful that you can apply in your company. Okay, let me now show you how this guidance is structured. Here on the left-hand side, you can see this annex from this CIR 2024/2690. And this annex is basically the most important part of this CIR. And on the right-hand side, you can actually see the table of contents from this technical implementation guidance. And here on the left-hand side, you can see that actually this annex from the CIR has these 13 sections. So section number one is about policy on the security of network and information systems. Section number two is about risk management. Section number three is about incident handling. Section number four, business continuity, and so on. And you can actually see exactly the same sections here in the guidance. So section one, policy. Section two, risk management. Section three, incident handling. Section four, business continuity, and so on and so forth. So as you can see, the guidance is 100% aligned with these sections in the CIR. Now let's take a look at this guidance itself. Let's see how is this first section, policy on the security of network information systems structured. And here you actually see how it looks like. You have this title, and then in this section you actually have a direct copy of what is exactly written in the CIR. So basically this is directly the text of the CIR, and then comes actually the guidance on how you could actually implement this text of the CIR in your company. Again, this is not mandatory, but there are lots of useful things here, and you should read it just to make sure that you are familiar with this. And then even more helpful is this example of evidence, right? Then basically the guidance tells you what kind of evidence you could have for this particular section of CIR. Again, this is not mandatory, but make sure that you read this through, because you will get lots of ideas on how you can do it. And then comes the next section, 1.1.2. Again, this is the quote directly from the CIR, and then the guidance for it, and then example of evidence for this. And then as the last section in this guidance for this top level policy are these tips. Again, some general guidance on how to implement this, and again some general examples of evidence. And then comes section 1.2, roles, responsibilities, authorities. Again, the quote from CIR and the guidance and evidence and everything else. And basically the whole guidance is structured in this way. Okay, together with this ENISA's guidance comes also this mapping table, where ENISA actually mapped the requirements of CIR against various frameworks. For example, you can see actually a mapping towards ISO 27001, NIST, cybersecurity framework, ETSI standards, CENTS 18026. These here are national frameworks. So this is a Belgium cyber fundamentals, then a Finnish one, Greek one, Spanish one, French, and so on. So very useful here if you want to quickly map the things against any of these frameworks. So for example, you can see that this policy on the security of network information systems maps directly into the clause 5.2 of ISO 27001, which speaks about the top level policy, and also Annex A.5.1, which is about the policies and procedures that you are writing for your ISMS. So very useful. You can also download this mapping from the same page where you download the guidance itself from ENISA website. Okay, and now I'll show you how to use this guidance when writing your own documentation, so your own policies and procedures. So if you don't have already some documents written, then you can simply use this ENISA's guidance as basically the kind of a blueprint upon which you will write your documents. So let's take, for example, this Section 6 about acquisition, development, and maintenance. So for Section 6.1, security and acquisition of ICT services or ICT products, if you don't already have some kind of a procedure or a policy which regulates the purchasing of these kind of services and products, then you can write based on this Section 6.1. So you have here 6.1.1, what the CIR requires, and general guidance, and basically this can be some kind of an introduction to your document. Then 6.1.2 is a little bit more detailed, and then you have the guidance, so this can be the second section in your document, and so on and so forth. And for section 6.2, this is about secure development lifecycle, so this one is quite different from the previous one. Previous one was about purchasing, this one is about secure development. Here you could have a secure development policy. Again, this could be some kind of an introduction, and then here you would have a more detailed description on how you set the requirements and so on. So basically this is the way to build a new document completely from zero. Now if you do already have a document, then you can simply double check it against the guidance and see if everything from the guidance is included. Again, the guidance is not mandatory, but since there are many I would say very clever things there, you should double check if all the appropriate ones are included, and then you can also add perhaps some kind of a notification or a section about the evidence that is expected. So let's see how we did it in Advisera when creating this NIS2 documentation toolkit. So you can see the supplier security policy here. When I scroll down, you will see the reference here to this ENISA technical implementation guidance, sections 5.1 and 5.2, since they are relevant for suppliers. And then you will see that there are all kinds of requirements there written. So this is mainly from CIR, of course, also double checked with ENISA. And then, for example, in this section 3.2, you also have several criteria on how you need to select suppliers. And then there is also this comment which provides you with suggestion of evidence that you could have for this particular requirement. So when you open this comment, you actually see that this is here a quote from ENISA guidance. And basically it says here all kinds of evidence that you did use these criteria when selecting suppliers, right? So this is something that is directly copied from the text of ENISA within this template, so that you know, users can very easily find out what they have to do. Now, of course, you do not have to use the comments. You can create a separate section which will specify all the evidence that is needed. It's really up to you to choose your approach. Since this is only a template and we didn't want to display this evidence as something that is required as is, because again, guidance is not mandatory. This is only as a comment. But if you already know in your company exactly what kind of evidence you need, then you can create a separate section which specifies what exactly needs to be produced.
Okay, I hope this was helpful. And let me know in the comments below if you have any questions about this ENISA guidance, and I'll answer as quick as I can. And to access these NIS2 documents that I was showing you, click the link in the description below, and you'll be able to access this NIS2 documentation toolkit, the free demo version, and you'll be able to download the free demo version of these policies and procedures. And in the next video, you'll also see how you can use this NIS2 documentation toolkit. And if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up, and you can also subscribe to my YouTube channel not to miss any of my new videos, and I publish videos about cybersecurity, compliance, and governance every week. Thanks for watching!